Please rise when your family's service song is sung.
Thank you.
United States Air Force Drill Team. The Old Dominion University Drumline and Color Guard. Chicago Wheel Jam. Please be seated.
A surprise Japanese attack on the U.S. Pacific Fleet at anchor at Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, dragged the United States into a world war which had begun in 1939. Mushroom-shaped clouds from two atomic bombs on Japanese targets brought an end to the worst war in world history. In between those two historical markers, over 50 million Americans would don U.S. uniforms and do battle with the Axis forces. Over 400,000 Americans would be killed or lost in action, and many more wounded or injured. For this generation, the war was not the first catastrophe they had faced. For more than a decade, they were growing up in the midst of the Great Depression. They rightly earned the title the Greatest Generation as they fought their way from Africa to Italy to Normandy's beaches. From the Bulge to Remagen's bridges, they fought their way mile after mile on into the heart of the Third Reich. In the Pacific, Americans would carry the battle to the Japanese in the wild jungles and mountains of New Guinea and on to the island-hopping campaigns of the U.S. Marines as they fought from Guadalcanal to Saipan to Tarawa and on to Iwo Jima. the United States would turn to helping rebuild much of what it had destroyed via the Marshall Plan created by President Truman. 15 million Americans in uniform were desperate to get out of those clothes and get back to civilian lives that had been on hold for 4 long years. Congress approved and financed a GI Bill that would send many of them back to colleges and universities to build a foundation for those new lives. The veterans and their needs and their contributions fueled an economic boom in the 1950s, and one of their own, General Dwight D. Eisenhower, would lead the country into that boom as president. By 1950, war would break out again, this time on the distant Korean Peninsula. War-weary American veterans and the reserve forces were called back on active duty and shipped to fight in Korea. Dwight Eisenhower would hand over the White House to a younger World War II veteran, PT Boat Skipper John F. Kennedy, in the 1960 election. Upon Kennedy's death by an assassin's bullet, yet another World War II veteran, Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson, would take over as president and slowly be dragged into yet another regional war in South Vietnam. World War II veterans have made and witnessed history over nearly a century. Now in their 90s, their numbers have dwindled to a precious few. Now we are come to this year's Virginia International Tattoo. We come to salute and honor those few old veterans still standing among us, and to mourn all those who have left us too soon. Farewell as the last of them accept our salute. God bless them all.
Taking the salute tonight, General Andre Lanata, NATO Supreme Allied Commander Transformation. General Mark Kelly, Commander Air Combat Command. Representative Elaine Luria, 2nd District. Representative Bobby Scott, 3rd District. And 3 World War II veterans, Colonel Walter Graves, United States Army, Lieutenant Commander Leo Dorman, United States Navy, and Lieutenant Commander Jack Castle, United States Navy. And now please all rise for the Piper's Lament and the playing of taps. Please be seated.
Virginia International Tattoo!